And so thank you for being here. We are carrying out this workshop, which is the 201st Mexican Expeditionary Air Force, a history of it. And we are looking at this particular event, a little known event. And it's because we're celebrating, we're getting ready to celebrate actually Hispanic Heritage Month. Hispanic Heritage Month was started back under Lyndon Baines Johnson and in the 60s, and it was a Hispanic week. And then actually Ronald Reagan said, hey, let's actually make it a month. And what they did was they straddled September and October. From September 15th to October 15th, that whole month we celebrate Hispanic Heritage Month. And the reason why we do so is because it was during that time, historically, the 21 Latin American countries gained their independence from Spain over a matter of years back in the early 1810s to 1820s. And so it's not just a Mexican holiday, it is a Hispanic heritage. But today what we're doing, we're going to be looking at the 201st Mexican Expeditionary Air Force, an incredible story, unheard of for the most part, but it was so significant. Okay, and there are some of the pilots of the Squadron A of this particular Air Force. And so it's subtitled Mexico Sends Its Best. All right. What we're going to do is we're going to do the presentation for about 40 minutes, 45 minutes. And then the last 15 minutes, we'll have some question and answer if any come up. Okay. And so let me start off with this. Mexico was actually one of the first countries to have an Air Force since 1915. Remember, this is not too long after what was it called? Flight by machines lighter than air, or lighter than air flight machines. It was in 1915 under President Carranza during the Mexican Revolution that they acquired planes from the United States. Many of the first pilots were American pilots, basically mercenaries or by contract that would come over. And both sides, the rebel side and then the federal side, both were using them for reconnaissance. And so they were hiring many times these pilots that were supposed to be adversaries in the air, but they're actually friends that had learned to fly in the United States, but on their at similar schools and similar experience. Now, an interesting little fact, a reconnaissance flight by the Constitutionalist Army, the Carranza Army, turned into the first aerial bombardment when he noticed an artillery position on the ground. He was just supposed to be actually taking notes and counting enemy formations and getting that information for the ground troops. And he saw this artillery position and he had a bag of oranges with him and he started pelting the artillery with his oranges. And that turned out to be one of the first aerial bombardments, if you will, during the Mexican Revolution. Another historical aspect was that the first air-to-air combat occurred during the Mexican Revolution. And once again, they were these American mercenaries that would fly, usually just to gain reconnaissance. But when they saw each other, they pulled out their pistols. And as they were flying by each other, they started shooting their pistols at each other, becoming the first recorded air-to-air combat. Okay. But that's not the point. The point is Mexico had an air force, and during the Mexican Revolution, they started using the air force. And then comes the 1940s. Remember, the Mexican Revolution expanded into 1920. Some people believe into 1926, 1929, when the Christ Wars were carried out. That's a whole other story by itself. But overall, Mexico then finally came to some period of peace in the 1940s. And during the 1930s, it had had an incredible president by the name of Lázaro Cárdenas. And Lázaro Cárdenas actually brought around a lot of the land distribution, a lot of the social reforms that had been promised during the Mexican Revolution, but had never really taken place. Another thing to look at is this. This is one of the uniforms that I possess, and that armament also, and those helmets, the flags, everything there. In fact, I usually carry this out in a traveling museum with about 200, 300 pieces of artifacts. Lisa, Alan, as we were planning this event, we thought, should we do it in person? And I wish we would have been able to do it in person, because then I would have been able to bring all the artifacts that I collect. I am a collector, a historian, and presenter. But I bring about this museum because, as you can see, those are French Adrian helmets. The Mexican army used to dress up like French soldiers, and they had German weapons. That's a Mauser right there, a Mexican Mauser, and Mexican Mauser bayonets. And you could say, you could ask, why is it that these soldiers, look at them, they're sitting there with their Mauser rifles, their French uniforms, and they live across the street from the United States, the arsenal of democracy. And that's because, well, they didn't really get along too well with the United States. Remember that it hadn't been too long ago that this is 1940s, 1941. It hadn't been too long before that the United States had invaded Mexico. And so Mexico was still kind of sore at them for this. 27 years earlier, Mexico had blockaded Veracruz. This is during the World War I period. Mexico had just received the Zimmerman telegram, the Germans telling them, hey, why don't you guys join us, attack the United States from the south, and then we Germans will attack from the eastern coast, and then we'll take over the United States, and we'll give you guys all the land that Mexico took from you in 1846. Carranza never acted on it. Why? Because the country was in the middle of a revolution. A civil war. It had no way of responding to that telegraph. But the United States saw that that Europe was still having a lot of influence in Mexico. And so it took over the port of Veracruz. It invaded the port of Veracruz. Mexico was not too happy with them. And then that man in the middle right there with the hat, standing right next to General Pershing, is Pancho Villa. Pancho Villa attacks Columbus, New Mexico, and he earns the ire and the pursuit of the American government. Pershing comes in, and he actually gets permission from Carranza to go after Pancho Villa in Mexican territory. And now Carranza earns the scorn and the hatred of the Mexican people because he let the Americans in. He let the gringos into the Mexican soil to go after this bandit / Robin Hood / revolutionary general. Okay. As a matter of fact, people hated Carranza so much that they wrote a special song about him. And I'm sure you have heard about it. Okay. It goes something like this. La cucaracha, ya no puede caminar. That cute little ditty is not made for cartoon fare. It was actually a corrido. It was actually a sung story about Carranza. They called him the cockroach. They said he was a pothead. They said he couldn't even walk around. Why? Because they hated him so much for what he had allowed. He had allowed Pershing, General Pershing, and they called him Blackjack Pershing. A lot of people don't know why they call him Blackjack. They thought maybe he was a gambler. Actually, it's because he was in charge of the Buffalo Soldiers, which were the African-American cavalry that was stationed in El Paso, Lisa, your hometown. Okay. And so General Blackjack Pershing is allowed with 10,000 men to pursue Villa into Mexico. Never sees him, never gets close to him, but he did have a couple of running battles with not just rebel forces, but also the federal government. Carranza realizes I made a big mistake. When he tells them finally to get out, he actually has to fight Pershing to get out. And there's a couple of pitched battles between federal troops and American troops. But the whole point is the United States, when they think of the United States, what Mexico, when they think of the United States, they're not too happy. They don't think of friendly neighborhood people who come over for a visit for coffee. They think of invaders. Not only that, in 1938, President Cárdenas, who turns out to be this incredible Robin Hood / Lincoln / Washington / FDR rolled up into one. He is Mexico's best president ever. They will never see another president like him. He actually brought around social reforms, health, roads, schools, land distribution. In Michoacán, they still call him Tata Cárdenas, which is our father, Cárdenas. He literally became and was seen as the father of his nation. He actually became very upset with British and American oil interests because he realized that they had bought the land, they had come over and surveyed it, and they started exploiting and drilling it for oil, but they were taking everything out of the country, all the holdings and all the earnings. They were not leaving anything from Mexico. So President Cárdenas expropriates, which means he just takes over. He nationalizes the oil fields, and he comes up with a constitutional law that says you can own the land, but you cannot own what's below the land. And so the United States and Britain break relationships with Mexico, and then they demand their money. And so Cárdenas says, I will pay you your money. Don't you worry about it. And actually, Mexico is doing a little bit better in their economy. But then immediately, as soon as the British and the Americans pull out, not only do they pull out from the oil fields, they pull out from most business deals. And so the Mexican economy comes crashing down. And this really causes Mexico to almost default on the loan. But historically, I remember reading accounts of they would have marchas del peso, peso parades, which is people would walk in a line down the street and whatever money, whatever they had, jewelry, whatever gold they had in their home, they would put it in the middle of the street. Mexican officials would come over and then use it to pay off the debt that they had for the British and the U.S. oil interests. Okay, so once again, bad blood because of Carranza. And Pancho Villa, bad blood because of the Americans invading Veracruz in 14, bad blood because of President Cárdenas expropriating the oil fields and stealing the what belonged to Mexico back. And then there was always Texas, all right? Still, there was always been animosity between Texans, the Texans and the Tejanos, the Mexican Texans. It's still there to some extent. In fact, my brother-in-law, Mario, says, you know, Texas is very simple to understand. On one side, you have the Mexicans. On the other side, you have the Germans. And they can't stand each other. They just don't like each other. He says, in fact, I can't think of one single German I like. Then he thinks about it for a second. He says, oh, wait a minute. My son-in-law, that guy is a great guy. So it's incredible how they can't live together, but they can't live together either. Okay. And so because of that bad history, Mexico is divided when it comes to making a decision of what are we going to do about this present war, this present world war? Everybody's choosing sides. And believe it or not, Mexico is having this internal discussion with itself, this argument. Should we join the Nazis or should we join the Americans? There were very many people who wanted to join the Nazis or at least support them. And this was the conservatives in Mexico. They were the Catholics. They were the businessmen. They were the military, the anti-Spanish Republicans. Remember, in 36 to 39, the Spanish Republic had come tumbling down. Because this was a socialist liberal republic, because it had been assailed by the Italian fascists, the German fascists, and the communists had come to their rescue, but it had been to no avail. Okay, and so Franco comes over and takes over Spain, and conservatives who liked Franco, they were Francoists, pro-Francoists, some of them straight out Nazi sympathizers and definitely anti-communist. They were all saying, these are the same people, the Nazis. These were the same kind souls that came to the rescue of Spain when it needed to be rescued from those liberals, those socialists, those communists, okay? And so many in Mexico said either join the Nazis or at least give our support to the Nazis. Now, many in liberal in Mexico were also liberals. And who were these? They were the worker union. They were the pro-Spanish Republicans. They were the anti-Francoists, the anti-socialists. They were socialists or pro-communists. They were anti-fascists and Nazis. Anti-clericals also. A lot of people in Mexico thought that the Catholic Church had a lot of power and it should be actually stripped from it. And also, their greatest benefactor, ex-president Lázaro Cárdenas, was entirely anti-Nazi and pro-Spanish Republican. As a matter of fact, Mexico shares an illustrious history and pedigree that it is the only nation that openly aided the Spanish Republic from 36 to 39 against the Nazis, against the Italians, against the fascists. They sent them weapons, they sent them munitions, they sent volunteers. And not only that, it was the only country, even when the United States had closed its doors to immigrants, from anything from Jewish immigrants to pro-Republican immigrants, Mexico was the only country that opened its doors and its arms to these refugees, the only country that did so. In the League of Nations, Mexico is the only country that stood up and said what the Nazis, what the Italians, what the fascists are doing in Spain. It is immoral. It is an attack upon humanity. And so over here, there's a little poster on the right, as you can see. There was actually conferences in Mexico. And this is El Palacio de las Bellas Artes. It's kind of like the Kennedy Center of Mexico, if you will. And this is put in by the Liga Pro Cultura Alemana in Mexico. This is the pro-German culture league. And you can see that what it's saying is, I know that they say that Nazis are beasts, that they are animals. But look, if you just cut off the cross beams, what you end up with is the Christian cross. Okay. And that was a very fascist / Catholic message that they wanted to send. If you vote for the Nazis, you're voting for Christianity. Not very even hidden here. I mean, it's just outright in your face. And I got to tell you, for a while there, up until 1940s, Mexico wasn't sure if it was going to go one way or the other. It was about even. And then something happened that turned everybody against Germany. And that's that. And why is it that they were even? Because Germany and Russia were friends up till the 1940s. But then Germany turns around and betrays Russia and invades Russia, creating a second front for the Nazis. And everybody in Mexico is aghast. Oh my goodness, I can't believe they did that. And so the liberals are saying, see, you can't trust the Nazis. They're doing the same thing that they did to Spain. And ex-president Lázaro Cárdenas by now, he becomes chief of the military and he starts pushing the current president, which is President Calles, to support the United States and to fight the Nazis, okay? So it's a little bit, and then as soon as the Nazis get wind of this, oh my goodness, Germany, the Axis powers, start attacking in 1942, sinking Mexican tankers in the Gulf of Mexico. El Fajo de Oro, El Llanero del Prado, El Potrero del Llano. Six ships get sunk. They lose 47 sailors. And in May 1942, Mexico declares war against the Axis powers, especially Germany, because it was German U-boats that had killed these 47 men. Mexico was incensed. They wanted to fight. And then at that point, they said, okay, we know who the enemy is now, and we know who our ally is, the United States. And here is a National Secretaría de la Marina, a National Navy poster, and it shows a Mexican sailor holding on for dear life, but at the same time holding up the tricolor, the Mexican flag. He pulls it out of the water, and the red wording at the bottom says, liberty does not drown. There's always a voice that will defend it. There's always an arm that will save it. And you see the man still with his last gasp of air raising the Mexican flag. And this was the feeling among Mexicans. They wanted to fight. They wanted to get back at the Germans, at the Nazis. And so this happened in 1942 and 1943. Roosevelt says, hey, you know what? Let's go have a meeting. We'll have it in Monterrey, Mexico. It became known as the Monterrey Accord. And let's come up with a plan that we can work together. We, the Americans, at that point, they bring this the sense that they are all Americans. And let's fight fascism together. Now, as I said, Cárdenas was very much behind it. And President Calles was very much behind it. And as a matter of fact, they were both very shrewd. Not just revolutionaries. Cárdenas more a socialist. Calles more of a neo-socialist. He was also a capitalist. And that's because he had gone to school in Harvard. And so he realized, you know what? I think we can make a deal here. Let's make do something here that will kind of benefit both the United States and Mexico. So they meet together and they decide to form the Joint Mexican-United States Defense Commission, which is let's work together to defend ourselves together. And the first thing that Calles goes meets with Roosevelt and says, Roosevelt, what do you need from Mexico? What do you need from us? Roosevelt says, I need all your Mexican raw materials, anything from your petrol. I need then your tin, your copper, your iron, your nickel. I got to build tanks. I got to build planes. I got to build munitions. Calles says, you got it. This is, I also need workers. All of my boys are either getting ready to go to the Pacific or Europe or Africa, or they're already there already. As a matter of fact, one of the members that we have joining us in the speech is Ron Rios. His dad actually fought and was supposed to head on over to Africa and fight. And he was one of those Texas boys, that Latino Texas boys, that ended up being part of the war effort. But because those Latino Texas boys were no longer able to pick the fields, the United States said, I need workers, I need field hands. And the program became known as the Bracero program, the field hands program. And Katya says, I will send as many workers as you need to all 47 United States. And Roosevelt says, 47, we have 48 United States. And Katya says, yeah, I know, you guys have Texas, and we're not sending our Mexican boys to Texas. They're just going to be abused. We cannot do that to our citizens. We cannot permit our citizens to be treated so poorly. And such was the case. Mexicans were being mistreated in Texas, and so the official accord stated they will send field hand workers. My father-in-law went in to work at a railroad yard, a hot house they called it, a roundhouse. And so Mexicans came into work everywhere in the United States except for Texas. And that's how Texas historically ended up with all of the German prisoners of war. Most of them settled into major camps in Mejia, Texas. It's incredible with Texas, when it realized that it wasn't going to have field hands, he said, okay, send me all the prisoners of war that you have. Okay. Now, the other thing is that Calle said, and hey, Roosevelt, about this whole expropriation and the debt we have. And Roosevelt said, consider it forgiven. And Mexico's debt was forgiven. The other thing was that Washington asked Mexico to please patrol the West Coast. And Mexico began patrolling the West Coast from Baja California all the way up to North California, which is our state, and sometimes up into even Washington, and then also the Gulf of Mexico. Now, Mexico had trained pilots. It had about 300 trained pilots, and a lot of its staff had been trained in the United States, and most of the centers that the future pilots would go and train. And that's just where Mexico got its training, in the United States, through exchange programs with its officers. But it had antique and antiquated, obsolete planes. So Roosevelt told President Calles, we'll start a land lease program. We will give you patrol boats for the Navy. We will give you artillery for coast. We will give you planes, P-40s. We will give you AT-6 Texan bomb divers. And as a matter of fact, the one recorded sinking of a U-boat in the Gulf of Mexico was carried out by a Mexican pilot flying an AT-6 Texas dive bomber. Okay. And so they also said, we'll give you all the technical training, and we'll help you set up your army, and we will help you set up your Air Force and Marines and Navy. And Mexico was just elated. And then also Mexico said, one thing we ask from you is put us into the fight. And a year before, the same thing had been said by Brazil to the United States. We want to send an army to Africa. And sure enough, Brazilians sent 50,000 men. But that was it. That's all they did. They sent men. They didn't have any weapons. They didn't have any transports. They didn't have any uniforms. And so the United States ended up outfitting 50,000 Brazilian soldiers to fight in Africa. And when Mexico said, we can give you another 50,000, they said, no, thank you. What we need is pilots. And Mexico said, yes, we'd love to go send our pilots up against the Nazis. And the United States said, you know what? We actually don't, you have fighters. What we need in Europe is bomber crews. In fact, they were being decimated, the bomber crews, in one flight over Dresden, one day bombing raid. Remember, the British would bomb by night because they had less resources and pilots. And the Americans, because they have the arsenal democracy behind them, they would bring in and do the bombing during the day. But it was costly. And one flight over Dresden, 60 planes, B-17s, were shot down. And that means that with a crew of 10, 600 airmen, just like that, evaporated, either died or were taken prisoners. So Mexico says, well, where do you want to send our pilots? And the United States says, we'll send them to the Philippines to fight the Japanese. Remember, we're fighting fascism. And it was a little bit of hard to get their heads wrapped around it. But Mexico finally said, you know what? Okay, we will send our men to the Philippines. Plus, they spoke Spanish. They spoke Spanish in the Philippines. And so thought, let's... They speak Spanish. Not only will they be able to help fight the Japanese, but they will be able to also do kind of hearts and minds sort of things with the Filipino people. And they did. Not only a lot of these men, remember, this was Mexico's best. A lot of these were all university men. A lot of them had came from very good families. They were educated and they had anything from architecture to engineering to agriculture knowledge that they could pass on to the Filipinos. And there's pictures of them on tractors and meeting with village people and helping them set up water stations and roads in Mexico. In the Philippines. And here you see President Roosevelt, and he is, Eleanor's over to the right, between he and Caius, and Caius's wife is to the left of President Roosevelt at the Monterrey Accord. Mexico wanted to help, and there is a poster from the war period, El Grito de Guerra. The Mexican hymn starts with Mexicanos al Grito de Guerra. It basically says, Mexicans, be ready for the cry of war. Be ready for action. Be ready to help. And here you see a young man waving the tricolor, the flag. In the back, one of the boats is sinking, and he's ready. He's saying, what do I do? I'm ready for war. It's interesting, a very idiosyncratic fact from history is that there in Mexico, there's an association of charros. Charro is the traditional Mexican cowboy. However, a charro is more than just a cowboy. A charro is considered an auxiliary cavalryman to the United States of Mexico military, which means that it's a reserve cavalry man. And that's why charros are allowed to carry rifles and allowed to carry live fire pistols with them. They have to be registered as a charro. It's almost like a military reserve, in this case, a cavalry reserve. And at the time, Mexico had a cavalry reserve of 150,000 men. And the leader of it, I forget what his name is. I was going to put it out here, but it's just too much information. Was present at the Monterrey Accord, and he offered his services to the American Army. And he said, if you guys need a cavalry, I have a cavalry that's 150,000 riders strong. Just give us a transport and put us anywhere in Europe or Asia that you want us to fight, and you will have the Mexican cavalry at your request. All right. So they were ready to fight and they wanted to fight. And so by act of Congress, Mexican Congress, the FAEM, the Fuerza Aérea Expedicionaria Mexicana, the Mexican Expeditionary Air Force is formed. They were supposed to send a wing. A wing is 100 pilots. And it's made up of three squadrons. And they say, we'll send a wing, but we'll send the first squadron for training and kind of just to practice it out and see how it will work out, and then send the other two squadrons following them. And the first squadron is called the 201st Squadron. And this is their banner right here. There's pictures of the men carrying this banner. It's about a 30 by 30 banner made out of silk. And it said Estados Unidos Mexicanos, which is the official name of Mexico, United States of Mexico, or United Mexican States. Ejército Mexicano, Fuerza Aérea Expedicionaria Mexicana. Okay. Interesting note is that both governments realized, you know what, this is the first time that we're going to put Mexicans in uniform, soldiers, military, in American soil. And there was still a lot of soreness, especially around Texas. So they said, one of the things that they said was, we are going to prohibit any FIAM personnel, anybody from the 201st, from carrying sidearms in the United States. They just didn't want any little misunderstandings or anything to go wrong. Okay. Now, a little test for you guys. You don't have to answer it, but answer to yourself. By the way, when is the only other time that Mexican military personnel has served in another country? It was called expeditionary because it was going to go fight in the Philippines. Okay. And there's been another Mexican expeditionary force. Anybody remember when that happened in our lifetimes? No? Okay. It was in September 2005. Mexico sent field kitchens and sent Marines to come and help with the cleanup of Louisiana after Hurricane Katrina. And there is our president, George Bush II, and he's shaking the hand of a Marine lieutenant and giving him thanks on behalf of the American people for coming over to help with the cleanup. Over in Kelly Air Force Base, the Mexican field units, kitchen units, were set up, and they fed tens of thousands of refugees coming over from Louisiana after Katrina hit. Okay, that was the only other time that Mexico has sent out an expeditionary force. So they start the training, and this is July of 1944. They cross the United States at the border of Nuevo Laredo, Tamaulipas, and Laredo, Texas, my hometown. And I remember reading about this in high school, Lincoln High School in San Jose, California. And I'm going home so excited and saying, Dad, did you know that Mexico sent pilots to fight in World War II in the Philippines? And my dad said, did I know about it? I was there. I saw them. And I said, no, really? He goes, yeah. He goes, Mexicans were so proud that we were sending this squadron of fighters. A squadron, as I said, is about 33. At one point, they had 36 pilots. But then they also had their own support. They had their own communications, quartermaster, their medical units, armorers and mechanics, and then secretarial staff. And so it all together, there was about 300 of them. And he says they came into the train, they got off the train, and then they all lined up. And they were the boys in olive green. Mexicans had olive green uniforms. And then they crossed the border and they came into the puente, the bridge. And he says that it was a Lincoln Juarez bridge. It's always, I crossed that bridge 1,000 times when I was a child. He goes, on the other side came in the boys from Fort McIntosh over on the Texas side. And they were wearing khaki. And the boys in green shook the hands of the boys in khaki. And then our boys in green went into the United States to get trained. Okay. That says Grandpa Jose had me on his shoulders, and I was a 7-year-old boy looking at all this happening. It was immense. I didn't even know how important it was. And here I am discovering this in high school that my father was there at that moment. So they get processed at Randolph Field in Texas. The medical team gets a flight surgeon training there. And then in Pocatello, Idaho, they go for flight training, and they show pictures of the pilots in Pocatello, Idaho. It was during the very cold time. And there was snowing, actually, and they're wearing these sheepskin lamb jackets. And the Mexicans finally said, hey, where are you sending us? Europe? And it says, no, we're going to send you to the Philippines. And they say, why do you have us out here freezing our butts off in Pocatello, Idaho? So the commands, the high command said, you know what? They're right. Let's send them back to a warmer area for training. So they get sent to Long Island, Farmingdale, Long Island, New York, for flight training, Victoria, Texas, for flight training, mechanic and armor training and quartermaster training, San Diego, California, flight training and gunnery training, and then Boca Raton for gunnery training, okay? And they finally say that they're going to be coming together in a little town in Texas called Greenville. Now, part of the museum had a chance to go show it to you. You would see this. This is actually a flight uniform that one of the Mexican pilots would have had. And over here on the right, you see a gala uniform that they would have worn. They had two variations of patches, actually three variations of patches. The first patch that they bring out, you couldn't even realize what it was. It was supposed to be an eagle, but it was hand embroidered, most of them, and with gold thread. And it just seemed like this gold purple meshy blob that you couldn't even tell. And it, not only that, it was like a 4.5 inch patch. It was a huge patch. But when they come to the United States and then change patches into this, that has now become the traditional 3.25 inch standard triangular patch for the United States. And then during the war also, then they, for the gala uniforms, they come up with a larger 4 inch circular patch that says 201st Fighter Squadron. Now, everything is American. And that's what I want you to realize. Remember where we started? The Mexican army was French uniforms with German weapons because they wanted nothing to do with the United States. This event brings Mexico so close to the United States that now you can't tell their pilots one from the other. The only thing that was distinctive about him was a Mexican cap. And as you can see right there, it doesn't look like the typical American slouch cap. It has more of a peak to it, almost like a Germanic, Prussian, or Italian cap, a droop side to it. And then if you look on top of it, the Mexicans, the only thing that the Mexicans maintain from their old Porfirio Diaz Prussian era. Porfirio Diaz wanted, this was from 1860 all the way to 1880 all the way to 1910. For 30 years, he was dictator. And he wanted Mexico to become a Prussian Germanic European state. Porfirio Diaz said, we have to learn from Argentina, let more Europeans in. He always wanted to make Mexico more European, more Anglicized to a certain extent. But that's all that remained of him, that little circular tricolor on the top of the peak cap. And that was called a cockade, a Prussian or German cockade. But as you can see in this picture, they transformed themselves into American servicemen, basically. They were Mexicans, they had the Mexico patch, but overall they were dressed up just like Americans. Even the wings, the only thing that you can tell the difference is because it has a tricolor, a red, white, and green in the center. Okay, and so as I said, the men come back from all their training and they come back together as a unit, and where do they pull them? In the infinite wisdom of the United States Army, which never makes mistakes, they put them in Greenville, Texas. Greenville, Texas. And this is their motto. I'm not kidding. The blackest land, the whitest people. That is, and by blackest land, it means it's earthy, it's agricultural land, but the whitest people just speaks for itself. They finally come together as a group there. And no sooner did they get there that they start facing discrimination and segregation. Pilots are not allowed to eat at restaurants or rent off-base housing. Okay, we serve whites only, no Spanish or Mexicans. The high command had to get involved, and especially after this happens. This is, by the way, Colonel Cárdenas, Antonio Cárdenas. He was a commander of the 201st. Usually, a part of a wing would have only a captain as the head of the wing. But in this case, because it was so symbolic, it was Mexico's first effort, they actually sent a full bird colonel. Okay, and he's going with his attaché, Captain Miller. Captain Miller was interesting. He was actually assigned after a disastrous incident in Texas where another attaché who had oversold his ability to speak Spanish actually ended up causing the death, the crash of one of the Mexican pilots who died in his plane because the officer did not speak Spanish as well as he had proclaimed. So they bring in Captain Miller, and Captain Miller is actually the son of a missionary that had worked in Bolivia. And so he had grown up with Hispanics, Latinos. He understood their language. He understood their emotions. And he's there by the side of Captain Cárdenas when they go to this restaurant in Greenville, Texas. And right there on the door, there's a big sign, no Mexicans allowed. Cárdenas spoke perfect English, and he sits there and he was just frozen. He didn't know what to do. He thought, should I go in? Should I not go in? I'm not allowed. Right at that time, the restaurant owner comes in, especially because he sees him. You know, he's a man of culture, obviously, and a man of with a colonelcy. And then he sees his attaché, Captain Miller, and he comes out and not really in an exculpatory manner. He basically says, this is not for you. Don't worry about it. Come in and eat. It's like, you're not that kind of Mexican. We meant the other kind of Mexican. So the following day, Cárdenas actually says that he really lost his appetite. He really didn't want to eat anything. But the following day, embarrassed Miller goes to the camp commander and says what happened. And the camp commander, the base commander, actually goes into town and closes the restaurant down and says, you will not be allowed to open until you allow any member of the 201st to come in here and eat. Not only that, he then met with the city leaders, the town leaders of Greenville, and he told them Mexican officers will be allowed to rent houses and apartments to occupy with their families. He says their families are going to come over right before they ship out, and they want to spend the last days, possibly weeks, with them before they ship out to the front. And then he reminds us, these are gentlemen, they are officers, and they are our allies. And so Greenville had to comply. Also in Greenville, an angel meets an angel. There was a second lieutenant, Angel Sanchez Rebollo, and he actually meets an angel, Nancy Hudson, a 17-year-old from Greenville, Texas. And they meet at a soda shop, and they totally fall in love. It's just love at first sight. So you can see a fine family from Greenville saying, what? You're dating a Mexican? Yes, but he's a pilot. I don't care. But he's a second lieutenant. I don't care. He's an officer and a gentleman. I don't care. And so they find nothing but barrier. And so they decide, the happy couple, to elope. They go to Brownsville, Texas, and then they get married. Incredible love story. I mean, this stuff should be made into a movie one of these days, I hope. And the two live happily ever after in Mexico City until their death in 1988. Okay. And another thing is they leave Greenville and they get on a Santa Fe Railroad and they end up in Camp Stoneman, which is Pittsburgh. It's just an hour up the road from us. Camp Stoneman is no longer there. It was right next to Port Chicago. But the 201st arrive at the military installation. They receive their vaccinations, their full equipment, their departure orders, and then they get on the Fair Isle, which was a transport ship out of San Francisco. So they were right here. I am sure they spent probably a couple of days touring the San Jose downtown or the San Francisco downtown area. And then when they arrive, this is another part of the traveling museum that you have. As you can see, they're out there now in their barracks outside in Luzon. And here are some of them still within their full dress. And this is the first of the emblem. One of them paints the emblem of the 201st Mexican Fighter Squadron, the Mexican tricolor, and then the eagle. That later on would become the patch that they would put on their uniforms. But they come in and they're ready to fight. They join the Luzon campaign. One of the things that threw off the American, they flew P-47s, which were known as the Jugs, or the, I'm blanking out on what they were called. They called them Jugs because look, it looks like a big old upside down jug bottle. What were the P-47s called? Thunderbolts. They were called the Thunderbolts. But the Mexicans, when they would talk to other American pilots, they would say, how was your flight? And the Mexicans would come in and go, oh my goodness, I was going down so fast that my pecua almost stalled. And then I was going in for a dive bomb and I pulled out too early and my pecua was banking to the left, pecua was banking to the right. And the American pilots would say, pecua, what's a pecua? And the Mexicans would pronounce P-47 in Spanish, P-47. And a pecua is just the first part of that phrase, pecua, P-47. Okay. They were supporting the 25th Infantry. In fact, I was about 3 years ago over at the San Jose Historical Museum in Kelly Park, and we were doing a workshop, a presentation on this. And one of the ladies stood up and said, you know, my father fought for the 25th Infantry in Luzon. And I said, well, the interesting thing is more than likely anytime he called for either machine gun support or for them to drop 100 or 500 pound bombs, it was probably a Mexican pilot that answered the call and was supporting them. There was a term known as flying like a Mexican, and this is a mix of a boxing term. In boxing terms, boxing like a Mexican means that you don't do rope-a-dope, you don't use a whole ring, you don't do any footwork, you're not, you know, Muhammad Ali. You basically just go straight in, kind of like Canelo, okay, Julio Cesar Chavez, and you just start swinging and wailing away at the guy in front of you. You just go directly and start fighting. You don't really, dance around the ring. And that's called fighting like a Mexican. Mexican pilots flew like Mexicans. They were known to really go in at a steep bank and at the very, very last possible second, pull out and then go off and after they drop their ordnance. And they would ask him, why do you do that? Why do you guys wait till the last minute to pull out? And the Mexicans would say, well, to make sure we hit the target. They just wanted to make sure that they were going to be effective. They realized that it wasn't just Mexico that was looking at him. They realized that the United States and the whole world was looking at him. It was 32 pilots, and they were trying to do their best. We have a testimony, a documentary testimony from one of the pilots that he's actually saying this is, you know, we didn't aspire to be a great military power. We were just Mexico. We sent one squadron, but we did our best. We wanted to know that when the time came, we chose the right side, the right side of democracy. Okay. Now, they're known as Pancho Pistolas. The 25th Infantry, they started calling the pilots Pancho Pistolas because they start putting in, and I don't know if you can see it right here, but this little Mexican rooster dressed up like a charro. And that actually comes from a Walt Disney movie called The Three Caballeros. I'm going to show you just 30 seconds of a clip right now. And this was Walt Disney's attempt at Americanizing this campaign, saying, hey, America is more than just the United States. It is the United States, but it is Brazil with its infantry in Africa. It is Mexico with its fighter squadron in Luzon, Philippines. And so Walt Disney comes out with this movie in 45 called The Three Caballeros. The three characters are Pancho Pistolas, the Mexican. You'll see him right now. He's the loudest. And then Jose Carioca, the macaw. He symbolizes the Brazilians. And then Donald Duck as the American, okay, symbolizing the American forces. So whenever the 25th Infantry would say, call in Pancho Pistolas, it basically meant call in the P-47s to give us some support. Okay, so here is just a quick little clip, and we are running out of time, so I'll make it fast.
In many countries around the world, a cowboy is called a caballero. So let's fly south for a song with my friends Donald, Jose, and Panchito.
Yeah! We're three caballeros, three gay caballeros. They say we are birds of a feather. We're happy amigos, no matter where he goes, the one, two, and three goes, we're always together.
Okay, so as you can see, that was an attempt at establishing a sense of brotherhood across the Americas. We're gay caballeros, we're happy, wherever he goes, I go. Later on, they'll say, whenever the weather gets rough or mild, we're going to stick to it together. When things get rough, we will stick together. So that was Walt Disney's attempt at saying, hey, this is an American effort. And by American, we mean all Americans, not just United States Americans. And so there was an unusual welcome and a lucky BB. And by that, I mean that when the pilots get to the Manila, there they are arriving with all their equipment. They are greeted by this Filipino-Mexican gentleman who's a businessman, and he's got his two beautiful Filipino daughters with him, and they're dressed in Chino Poblana outfits, which are these beautiful embroidered Mexican dresses, and charro hats. And the Mexican pilots are like, oh my goodness, a little welcoming committee. And it turns out a lot of people say, oh, this was the governor of the Philippines. No, it wasn't. Oh, this was the mayor of Manila. No, it wasn't. It was actually this Mexican-Filipino businessman who was acting as the ambassador for Mexican affairs in the Philippines. Because he had business in Mexico and the Philippines, he was allowed by the Japanese to actually act as an intermediary. And so it was a lucky BB also, because if you see that man right there standing behind a lovely young lady, that is Lieutenant Lopez Portillo. And he was the only Mexican pilot to be shot down. He was on his flight and he never pulled out from his dive. And when they found him, they found that he had one single bullet in his head, one single BB, you might say. The Japanese had 25 caliber, which is really small bullets, 25 caliber machine guns. They had the slowest cycle of any machine gun in the World War II. And apparently they called it a lucky BB because some Japanese soldier was just spraying the sky with his machine gun. And one of them, without being aimed, just hit him right on his head. And he never had a chance to recover from his dive. He was the only pilot that was actually shot down. You have this incredible situation, Mexicans, Americans, Filipinos, Chinese, and Australians. Now, you might say Chinese, these are the Philippines. Yes, there was actually Chinese guerrilla forces operating in the Luzon area, along with Filipino rangers and militias also. Now, the Mexicans, they amass an incredible record compared to Americans. They would usually go up twice a day. Even though they were in operation for only 3 months, they actually put in an incredible number of bombs dropped, strafing runs, and support sorties for the 25th Infantry. They were supposed to be used in the invasion of Japan. However, at the end, they said, you know what? I think by this time, Washington knew that they were going to drop the devices on Japanese land. And so they said, let's hold off. They were supposed to be taking part of what was known as Operation Olympus, which was the invasion of Japan. So instead, what they were used was to carry out planes, P-40s, P-47s, and other planes, from the Philippines into Isla Formosa. Now, Isla Formosa is Portuguese for beautiful island, what we now know as Taiwan. And by this time, Chiang Kai-shek was moving its nationalist army from mainland China, because now he was being accosted by Mao Zedong, a communist, and now he was moving his forces over to Formosa, and who that would become Taiwan. All you have to do now is read the newspaper and realize that that story is still alive in our very day. And so they carried also coastal and submarine reconnaissance and also some cleaning sorties in Taiwan to get rid of the last of the Japanese. In November 1945, the 201st Fuerza Aérea Expedicionaria Mexicana arrives at San Pedro, California, after a month's travel from Manila. This has been so fast. Now, before we end with the last couple of points, I just wanted to let you know something interesting. Pepping the boys up, one of my displays that I have, you can see right there, it's a display of cigarettes and Mexican cigarettes, American cigarettes, and of course, Lucky Strike military cigarettes. And then some photos, some, what do you call it, matches from the period. And it's important to know that all armies gave their men stimulants or depressants to either get them ready for battle or relax them after one. The French gave their men wine, okay? The British gave them beer. It was warm beer, and that's enough, I think, to make anybody fight. I think that's the reason why they gave them war, so they would be upset. They had not heard of refrigeration, I think. The Americans were a little bit more puritanical. They didn't give beer or wine. They gave their men all the coffee and cigarettes that they needed, okay? And does anybody know what the Germans gave their men? That's right, methamphetamine. And this is where, not the myth, but the reality of the German Übermensch, the Superman, came from. That, yeah, these guys would pop in those pills and they could fight for 2-3 days straight without sleeping. This was actually prescribed and given to all the Wehrmacht. And that's why when they marched across the Ardennes or in the Battle of the Bulge area, or even when they went around the Maginot Line through Belgium, all the German soldiers were speeded up. Okay, so it's interesting. Now we come to the end of the war. After the war, the 201st returns home to a hero's welcome in Mexico. All the fallen are repatriated. They had very few deaths. Some of them had died from diseases. Some of them had died from Japanese attacks on the ground while they were manning the fields. I think altogether 13 soldiers, servicemen died. Now, there was the United States and Mexico had much, much improved relationships. Remember, they had started this war with which side should we choose? And luckily, Calles and Cardenas led Mexico to the side of the United States. As part of the Monterey Accord, all debt is forgiven. Not only that, the British also forgave their debt and reestablished relationship. Now, Mexico had a modern and trained Air Force, Navy, and Marines. And because of all the investment in the raw industry of Mexico, now they had this incredible industry that employed many, many Mexicans, and still a resource-rich Mexico is still benefiting from that development. Here they are, the 201st, El Glorioso 200, Escuadrón 201, coming back to Mexico. Remember, they left dressed almost like French. You can see the French uniform still on the right-hand side and on the left-hand side, but the Mexican soldiers that came back were fully Americanized. And then one of the most important things, the lasting effect, is the Bracero program. Remember I told you all those workers that came over to Mexico? Eventually, over 500,000 men would come to work in the United States, among them my dad, my father-in-law. And many of them, most of them went back, but many of them decided to make their home here. But those that went back with American dollars. And so they were able to invest those dollars and make really build the Mexican middle class. And you know that economically, the best thing that brings stability to a nation is a strong middle class. And that has allowed Mexico to remain strong to this day. Many of the workers stayed in the United States and became the nexus of the 45 million Latin Americans, mostly Mexican citizens, 50% of the population, which now populate our nation. Mexico sends its best. There is President Lyndon Baines Johnson signing the 1965 Immigration Act. And then there is President Reagan signing in the Hispanic Heritage Month in 84. Mexicans have enjoyed a privileged status under both Republican and Democratic presidents since the war. And more than ever, it's important to remember that Mexico usually sends its best to the United States. It sends people who want to work. It sends people who are conservative. It sends people who want to be patriotic. We can't forget that. Also, that has brought us something very special, which is it's healing and peace. We have had 100 years, over 100 years of peace along the borders of our two countries. And if you're saying, big deal, all you have to do is look at the China-Vietnam, China-Mongolia, China-Tibet, China-Philippines, China and Japan, China and Taiwan, or my goodness, Middle East, any of the Middle East, or my goodness, Georgia, Crimea, and now Ukraine, to realize that peace is something that is very ephemeris. It's there 1 second and it's gone the next. And for our nations to have 100 years of peace, that's saying something. And this man, these 32 pilots and 300 servicemen, did something incredible. They basically put themselves at an arm's way, and 13 of them did not make it back. And they have really contributed to this peace that we have now here. I was talking to my children and letting them know what it is that we do. And I tell them what we do is we curate the past and curate as collectors. What we do is it comes from the Latin word curare, which means to care for or to heal. We take newspapers, we take uniforms, we take boots, we take helmets, and we clean them, we oil them, we make them, we preserve them. Why? Because history teaches, history, we heal history, because then history heals us. And as we curate it, it curates us. History teaches that it's inaccurate to say things have never been this bad. Oh yeah, they've been this bad and they've been worse. Or that things will never be good again. Oh yeah, they will be good again. Remember, at one point, we call the Japanese animals. We call them vermin. We call them insects. We call them monsters. And they called us the same things. And now what do we call them? The great market and peaceful partner of Japan. It just tells us that we have forgotten our history and we have to remember our history. So that's why we cannot forget. And I end with this quote from George Santayana, a Spanish philosopher. Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. We cannot forget the 201st Mexican Expeditionary Air Force. We cannot forget the Mexicans, Americans, Filipinos, Chinese, and Australians fought together for a common cause and gave their sweat, blood, and lives for a common purpose. And we cannot forget that Mexico continues to send its best. And if we treat them like the best, they will be the best for our nation. And right now, our nation needs every single strength and every single possibility and reason for unity, because the beasts, because the aggressors are out there. And we, our countries and our nation and our world is really set for a major turmoil. And the United States is going to need all the allies that it can find as we get ready for this next adventure of our history. Oh, my goodness. This was so fast. Thank you, Lisa. I know that we wanted to have some time for questions. It's already 8:00. Lisa, if you allow a couple of questions, I wouldn't mind at all. Hope you enjoyed it. Any questions, any comments?
Yes. Anybody who has a question, please feel free to enter it in the chat box. Or if you would like, you can unmute yourself and show your video if you'd like to ask Dr. Lopez your question directly. Thank you so much, Dr. Lopez. I learned so much. I don't know if much of this is taught these days in high school American history. But yeah, you obviously learned about it from Lincoln High.
I learned it by going to the library, Lisa, and actually looking up. There was a series of books called The World at War. And I remember pouring through each one of those books. But I'm talking to Mexican people who have come to our presentations. And they tell us, oh, that's what 201st is. Because in Mexico, you'll walk in these neighborhoods that, you know, the 201st Squadron neighborhood, or the 200, there's even a band called 201st Squadron, and nobody knew what it was named after.
Oh, my God. Wow. Yeah.
But a lot of it really, as I said, it was a sacrifice, literally, like Churchill said, so few gave so much, so that so much improvement and so much peace could exist between two nations. Any questions, comments? Nobody?
I have one question about the, you mentioned that one of the, was it a boat that was bombed in the Gulf of Mexico by Nazis? So was it a Nazi submarine?
Yeah, the U-boat. In fact, the U-boat sank six petrol ships, six tankers, and that's what drove Mexico to declare war. Let's see. Paulina says there was a treaty that the United... Oh, Paulina, what happened? Paulina said there was a treaty the United States made with Mexico and to end its aircraft development. Do you know what it was called? Oh, my goodness. The treaty to end Mexico, the aircraft development? No, I'm not sure when that would have happened. I'll look into that. Maybe, nothing comes to mind. A treaty that the United States made with Mexico to end its aircraft development. There's been a couple, actually Mexico has tried a couple to build its own weapons factory lately, and it's been done a lot of work with the Japanese, the Israelis. I'm sorry, not the French, the Israelis, the Swedes, the Germans. But usually for lack of economic means, it has not really developed its own weapons industry. Right now, all it does is it has some manufacturing rights from the United States and from Germany and some French for some light weapons. It was done to eliminate aircraft competition between these two countries because Mexico was ahead of the game. Yes, in the beginning, Mexico was ahead of the game. And really, if you look at the history books, the first flight done by man was not by the Wilbur brothers.
Right. The Wright brothers.
The Wright brothers. Yeah, it was actually done by a Brazilian, Dos Passos, I believe was his name. So look it up. I mean, I've been at the Washington Air and Spacecraft Museum many, many times, and they have Dos Passos aircraft design right there. And right there it said, arguably the first flight by man was made by a Brazilian. Okay, but once again, if you don't read it, you'll never know it. Any last comments, questions? Confessions.
Oh, somebody, Alejandra, do you mind to repeat the book you mentioned you read before? Oh, was it The War of World?
The World at War.
The World at War, yeah.
Yeah, oh, I have them all downstairs. It's a series of books. It's 37 books. And I remember that you could buy them. It was one of those that you would be watching TV and go, so Time Life magazines and books, you know, buy The World at War. So send $9.99 plus shipping and handling and you'll get this book. And I love those books. And finally, now as an adult, I ended up just looking and searching for the whole collection. I finally amassed all 37 books. But yeah, incredible stories there. But overall, just start, you know, Googling Brazilians in World War II, Mexicans in World War II. One thing also is Argentina, Paraguay sent a number of pilots to fight with the RAF fighting off the Germans. The Latin American states had a limited yet very effective and very proud involvement in the war effort. And it really was, I mean, it changed the world in more ways than one. Anybody else? The World at War. Okay. All right. I think that's it, Lisa.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Lopez. And thank you, everyone, for coming to today's